Okay, so I'll just, sorry to turn it back to you, but I'll talk to the group and then I'll introduce you and we can get started.
No problem.
Okay, I don't know if this is everybody else's first virtual meeting, but it's my first virtual meeting and I think it's cool. Camera's here, microphone's here. This is Marilé and she is going to be our representative. He's gonna take us through our learning this morning. And so we will be following directions from her. She is in Virginia. And so any questions that you guys have, I guess we'll follow her protocol, whatever she, however she wants to handle, you know, those kinds of things. And if y'all need to move around in the room to be able to see or hear better, then please do so. So I'm gonna let her take it away.
Okay, thank you so much, Terry. And good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Thank you so much for being here today. We do really appreciate it. I think it's a unique opportunity. My name is Marilé Colón Robles. I'll just say it one more time. Marilé Colón Robles. My first language is actually Spanish, it's not English. So you'll kind of notice that with my name. But I am the education specialist here at NASA Langley Research Center in Hampton, Virginia, which is where we run the Rockets to Racecars program, where we compare the correlations between NASA and racing. There's a lot of different things, and it really helps your students understand better things like forces and motion and hydration and things like that. So what we're gonna be doing today is kind of going through one of the four main topics, which is aerodynamics and Bernoulli. Now, the way that we're gonna do this is we're gonna start off a little bit now with me, and then we're gonna ask you to go into the badge system. Which, does everybody have the link into the badge?
Yes.
Perfect. I've been sending you guys some emails, and as well, I'm gonna be showing an app from an iPad. So if you guys have an iPad or have that app, you can follow along with me as well, just in case you do have some liberty in using systems like this in your classroom. So I do want to learn a little bit more about you guys. Can you guys tell me your names? I know that you all teach sixth grade. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
So if I at least know your names, and I guess, what are you hoping to learn from Bernoulli's principles from today's session?
Maybe you want to start? Go ahead.
I'll start. My name is Brian Rich, and teach sixth grade. Thing that seems interesting about this is finding new ways to bring in fascinating aspects for the students to access the knowledge that we're trying to get across to them.
Okay, perfect. Thank you, Brian.
I'm Sheila Green. I'm also a sixth grade teacher, and I'm excited about this. We're about to start our rocketry section of space travel.
Okay. Unit.
So I think this will be a great time.
Yeah, thank you, Sheila. Sheila, right? Sheila? Okay, perfect.
And I'm Jill. I teach with Sheila and Jennifer. I've been to lots of NASA workshops, so I kind of know how NASA works, and I love the way they put things together. They really help you kind of bring it up to the next level. So I'm looking for that way to bring the whole speed and motion thing up to a higher level.
Okay, perfect.
I'm Jennifer Reynolds, and I teach sixth grade science and eighth grade science. So I love space in that unit for my students because they're super excited about it and interested. So just finding new and different ways to work with the students. And it's also cool because I teach eighth grade science, which ties in with the universe and stars. And so I was hoping maybe to see if there's anything I could incorporate a little bit with my eighth graders too.
Okay, perfect. Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you, Jill. I didn't address you, Jill.
All right, I'm Lori Toddy. I teach sixth and seventh grade science, and I'm excited just about the whole NASA and space and bringing it to the kids. They were really excited to hear that I was coming to training today. Even though it's the day before spring break, they were like, bring us back good stuff. Oh. So excited to be involved with NASA. Anything with NASA, the kids get really excited about.
Awesome. Thank you, Lori.
I'm Andrew Stewart, and just excited to figure out how to make learning more fun for kids in the classroom.
Thank you, Andrew.
I'm Lindsay Warren, and I'm really
really excited. All my students were the same way. They were bummed that I was going to be out, and then they heard where I was going, and it's a whole different story. But I'm really kind of in the same place as you. I want to make it more fun and relevant. Sometimes the curriculum in sixth grade seems obscure, and especially when we start talking physics. And when we can make it relevant like this to them, it makes all the difference.
Right, right. Thank you. Lindsay, right? Lindsay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Jason Deerdorf, and I also teach sixth grade science with Lindsay. And I'm probably most excited about just giving the kids a new opportunity, something kind of fresh, and relating it to real world type applications with NASA and NASCAR.
Perfect, yes. And we are hoping that you guys see the correlations and also see ways that we even haven't thought of so far. Okay, so we are also looking for your expertise and your unique ways on how you see this material also being taught. So thank you, Jason.
I'm Michael Anderson. I teach with Allison over here, and I'm looking for, I think the kids understand NASA, they understand NASCAR, so it's kind of a real world thing, and I think it's good to be able to apply what they already understand with what we're going to teach them.
Okay, perfect. Thank you, Michael.
I'm Allison Esparza. Pretty much the same that everybody's basically said. I mean, it's real world application. So.
Awesome. Thank you, Allison.
I'm Ashton Lovren. Same thing everyone else has been saying. I told my kids I was going to a training when I said NASCAR and NASA. They got really excited. I just kind of had to apply it to the real world and just keep them engaged. Especially, you know, this time of year. So, looking forward to this unit.
Awesome. Thank you, Ashton.
My name is Kara Forrest. I teach sixth grade science as well. And like everyone said, I'm just excited about introducing this unit in a new and different
one. Awesome. Was that Kara?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, perfect.
And that's everyone. The only other two people in the room are me and our science coach, Miranda. She helps with all things middle school and high school science. So
okay, perfect. So thank you so much. So it is, I wrote down all your names and all your uniqueness, because one of the things is we're going to start off now just a little bit, kind of like a touch on, and then I'm going to let you guys work through the badge. I did see a few names in the badge, but you will have time to go through the badge, and then we'll reconnect. So that'll give you time also to look through kind of the main topics that we're going to be touching on. It's mainly aerodynamics, Bernoulli's principle, Venturi. When we touch back, that is your opportunity to, we're going to be doing some problem-based learning activities. You guys are going to be working in teams. I'm going to warn you now, we're going to be working on teams, and each of you will have a particular role in that team, and we're going to see which team does it best with the problems that I'm going to be throwing at you. But I want to make sure to touch on especially the space unit, because I heard a lot of space in there. So I want to make sure that when we touch back, I bring some more examples about space and the aerodynamics, because there is a lot of correlations, especially as we try and explore other celestial bodies. As long as they had an atmosphere, aerodynamics applies. It doesn't matter how far away you are from Earth. That's the really exciting portion of that. Okay. Also, you all have my email, so please email me back and forth. My job is here to be for you guys, and to see when you bring in a problem or you bring in, I would like to do this in my classroom, is there anything that could work? That is my job, is to identify the best NASA activities, or the best NASA videos, or even try and get you a subject matter expert. I know that because you guys are going to be going through this program, you guys will have a connection with Jimmy Johnson, which is very exciting, the master of aerodynamics for the 48 team. And then us here at NASA, we have a lot of engineers that their job is to travel through an atmosphere as we explore other bodies, especially Mars, as our journey to Mars. So please feel free to either communicate with me through email, communicate with me through the badge. And also after you go through the badge, when we reconnect, make sure that I'm meeting your needs, okay? That is my main goal, is to meet your needs. So I want to share a little bit about where I'm connecting from. So this is really neat. Thank you, Terry, and everybody for doing all the efforts to make sure that we are doing this connection virtually. I am connecting from NASA Langley Research Center, and we're about to celebrate 100 years. Now, NASA per se is not 100 years old, but we are in the very first of the NASA centers when it started as NACA, N-A-C-A. And this is very significant for our topic today because it's all about aero or aerodynamics. So let me go to the PowerPoint that I have here just to show you some neat pictures. Okay, so aerodynamics is the study of air moving through and through the atmosphere, through the air, okay? A lot of the same rules applies to fluids, anything that is a fluid, right? So ships, there are programs where they teach aerodynamics and fluid dynamics, or how the water behaves, so like submarines and things like that, ships, because the same rules apply. Aerodynamics is just concentrated to studying of air movement around objects. And here are just some objects that have been tested in wind tunnels here at NASA. We test anything from the soccer ball for the latest tournament to the new rocket, the SLS rocket here in the top. In the top right, that's the new SLS rocket, which is going to take us to various places, to the moon, to Mars, to an asteroid. It's going to be taller than the Statue of Liberty. When it's complete, it's much taller. It'll be much taller than the Saturn V rockets, which are the ones that took the Apollo missions to the moon. So it will be a sight to see once we start testing those rockets. But we need to figure out how it'll move through the atmosphere as it's battling against gravity. And of course, we do test cars and different objects. So aerodynamics, in a sense, is how do objects move through air. Okay, so this is where I would like for you guys to know about this app. Now, how many of you guys use iPads or tablets or anything in your classroom? Okay, perfect. So I am going to show you, there's a wind tunnel app, which is the one that we prefer the most. And I sent you guys the link to it. There's a free version and there's a paid version. I'm going to show you guys the free version. Okay, so here's my app, the wind tunnel app. And the uniqueness of it is that you can put different objects. So let me put a car, and you'll see the air flowing. Now, this is a little bit difficult to see, but I can turn on speed, and you'll see the colors. Make sure that, okay. You'll see the colors and the color changes. So anything that is red is faster moving speeds. Anything that's purple or bluish is slower moving speeds. So as you're looking at the designs of objects, again, aerodynamics is how the air moves around an object, you can see where certain spots make air go faster or air go slower. And that's what we're going to be talking a lot about today, because knowing how to make air go faster or slower around different designs will probably have you either win the race or make sure that that rocket is able to lift off. Okay. So what I'm doing is there's a little plus on the bottom. I'm opening that and I go into load, and there's different options there. This is, again, the free option of objects to look at. So that's the airfoil shape right now. If I go into river, you can also see rivers. Okay, because again, water is a fluid, so it'll behave the same as air. The same equations will behave. And what I turned on was the speed to see the colors of the air behaving. Now there is also pressure. You can look at pressure and see where high and low pressures are. You can look at smoke plumes. Or then the particles, which is easier to look at when you have the iPad right in front of you. It's not as easy to look at now that I'm sharing. So I'll take it back to speed because it relates most to what we're talking about today. Okay, so it's the study of looking at how different shapes and how the air behaves as it moves around different shapes. And again, air is a fluid, so you can do the same thing for different shapes. So when we're looking at, if you look at a rocket, the shape is to move all that air, to make it move as smoothly as possible, so that it's not creating forces to hold it back. When we're looking at a car, like we did on the iPad, there's different things that are going on. There's areas where there are, the air is going faster, and there's area where it's going slower, and that's by design. And we'll go a little bit more into that when we're talking about lift and downforce. Okay, and you'll do that through the badge. Now, again, I am from NASA Langley Research Center. It's the very first of all the NASA centers, and it started right after the Wright brothers took flight. And if you notice, on the top right is the emblem for NACA, and NACA stands for National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics. And it started in 1917, right after the Wright brothers took flight. So if you notice, even in the middle of the emblem, you'll notice the picture right there of the Wright brothers. So there is a lot of history. NASA Langley Research Center was where the very first of all the wind tunnels here in the US was. Let me go back to right here in the bottom left. That's the very first wind tunnel, and it's still here at NASA Langley, and arrived to the Newport News shipbuildings in 1922. So there's a lot of history. And the top right is the very first pictures of the movement of air and the sonic boom through an airfoil, which is that shape. Okay. And then in the bottom right is one of the very first wind tunnels that could hold an actual airplane or actual real size experiments. So there is a lot of history. So we are very proud of that history, and we're very proud that the NASA Rockets to Race Car program lives here, because it makes so much sense because of the aerodynamics history. So at NASA Langley, we have the experts of traveling through an atmosphere, either Earth's atmosphere or other planets' atmospheres. Now, when we're talking about aerodynamics, we have to talk about forces. And this is just a review, right? Forces, a force is equal mass times acceleration. So when we're going through a lot of the problems that you guys are going to be, the challenges that you guys are going to be working through, we need to think about that you'll be causing an acceleration. You're going to be changing something in order to cause a force to act upon the samples that we're going to be having. Okay. Again, this is another great opportunity to talk about kinetic energy and potential energy. And these examples you might find, your students might be most the ones that they see the most relative to potential energy and kinetic energy. But we also see them in nature. If you think about how things shift, okay? So if you think of an air parcel, and you think we're talking about now weather, and you have a bubble of warm air, that air rises, and expands and it cools, but that force can be so strong that it'll lead to thunderstorms, and these thunderstorms can grow so, so strong that can lead to tornadoes. And those types of storms just started because something was pushed or something was in an unbalanced state. So everything that we're going to be thinking about, we need to think about what are the forces that are kind of tugging against each other? What is the tug of war? And which one is winning the tug of war, or is it neutral? Okay. Now, other examples in nature as well. Is here just the temperature changes and why we have winds. Okay, winds are created because of the change in temperature, the change in pressure. So wherever you have those colors, so the colors on the map right now are temperature. So the purples and the blues are really cold temperatures. The reds are really hot temperatures. Everything yellow and green are warm temperatures, not necessarily very hot, but wherever you have a really strong change, like in Florida, Florida is going from really red to green, that'll lead to a lot of wind or very strong winds to try and get that balance back together. Everything, why we have winds, why we have fronts, is trying to cool down all those areas that are warm and to warm up all those areas that are cooling off. Okay, so are there any questions so far with those examples?
Nope.
Everybody okay? Okay, good. Now, when we're talking about flight, there are four forces. Does anybody know those forces? The forces of flight?
Lift,
drag,
thrust.
So I think I heard three, right? I heard lift, drag, thrust.
Gravity.
And gravity, very good. Okay, so those are the four forces that are kind of tugging at each other. And once they're, if they're all balanced, then everything is stable. Once one of them is unbalanced, then we either have lift or more lift and weight, or we have more thrust and drag. So let me show you guys the forces. And in this image, you'll notice that there's green and there's red. So those that are opposite of each other, those are, that's the tug of war. And the thrust is the power that the airplane is putting to move forward, but there's drag pulling you back. We create lift, and we'll talk about how lift is achieved, but weight or gravity is always pulling against lift. So again, the tug of war, and how these forces are perpendicular, are always going to be perpendicular to each other. So in the bottom right picture, you'll notice the jet going kind of in a slant. Thrust is always going to be where that jet is going to, and lift is going to be perpendicular to that thrust. So all these forces are going to be, lift and thrust are going to be perpendicular, and drag is always going to be on the opposite of thrust. Now there's different things when the forces are unbalanced, and we want them unbalanced to achieve either thrust or to achieve lift. And there's different ways that we can do this, either by having the power of the engines or using the wings or the wing shape to create lift more than drag. And one of the things that we use is the airfoil shape, and it's the shape where it's curved on the top and flat on the bottom. So it's curved on the top and flat on the bottom. And that'll lead to air going faster over the top because there's a curve there, and going slower over the bottom. And this is what's called the airfoil shape. And if you notice in the picture, is the tip of the wing. So the wing shape is what's called the airfoil shape. Okay. So we go here. When we draw the airfoil shape, we have a curve and a flat end. And the air is moving this way. Now, when we force a fluid around a curve, it'll go faster. In the bottom, the air can just flow freely. So in comparison, the air on the bottom goes slower. Is that inverted for you guys? I'm sorry.
That's fine.
No,
it's fine. It's fine? Okay. Now, does anybody know what Bernoulli's principle is?
Yes.
Thank you. What Bernoulli tells us is whenever you have a fast moving air, you'll have a lower pressure. So if you think about it, when you take a snapshot of what's happening, you'll actually have less air molecules over the top, creating that lower pressure. Wherever you have slower moving air, you'll have more air molecules accumulated, so that'll create a higher pressure. So when we're looking at faster speeds, so fast speeds or slower speeds, faster moving air leads to lower pressure. Slower moving speeds leads to high pressure. Now, when you have a competition, when you have a lot of something, so higher pressure just means that there are a lot of more air molecules compared to the top, there's less air molecules. And we know that those air molecules are pushing in every direction, right? So there's more air pushing on the bottom of the airfoil compared to the top of the airfoil. That's why it's higher pressure on the bottom where it's flat, lower pressure on the top where the curve is. Now, this is important because what is the net force that results from this? Who's winning the battle? The side that has most air molecules or the side that has less air molecules? Can you say that again? Sorry?
The side with the most.
The most, right? So everything goes from high pressure to low pressure. So the net force or the result will be an upward motion, and that is lift. So when you're looking at designs, looking at shapes, or even looking at the rivers, rivers are going around a curve, you'll notice a difference between pressure and speed. And if you can manipulate that to help you win the race or help you fly a rocket, then you can either obtain lift or whatever force needed to overcome gravity or to overcome drag? So I want you guys to, how many of you have gone through the badge already? Just very few, right? Okay. So I want to walk through the badge. In the badge, you'll have videos and some reading to dig a little bit deeper into what is lift, what is Bernoulli's principle, and what is downforce. Now, downforce is what's used in NASCAR. Does anybody know what downforce is right now?
What was the question?
She's asking, yeah.
Okay, so I'll let you guys discover it in the badge. Okay, but downforce is what the NASCAR drivers use, or the racing industry uses, to keep the cars on the track surface so that it can go faster. If you keep the car on the track surface, it'll have more grip, meaning that it can use the surface to go faster. And it's all based on the difference between high and low pressures, okay? So let me walk you through what you're gonna see to go into the badge. And when you go into the badge, that's you guys, I'm sorry. When you go into the badge, you'll have to do a profile. I did a very simple profile. I'm in the dashboard, okay? Your main ways to navigate are on the side, right here on the side. The first one is dashboard. Second one is explore. It kind of looks like a compass. If I go there, this is a growing community for all of you guys in different topics. So you'll see the latest ones that have been added, latest badges. I want you guys to go into badges. Like you can see all of the badges. And then you'll see NASA R2R, Aerodynamics, and Bernoulli. You'll click there. You'll see my name and all the people that created this badge. We'll start this badge. And you'll see the different steps right here. Okay. I want you guys to just do step one and step two. We kind of already did a little bit of that. And step one is a simple video that you can actually use in the classroom. It talks about the forces of flight with examples. And then here I'm giving you a link to Google Hangout that we did with Jimmy Johnson and NASA engineer Jill Prince. What I'm going to ask you guys to do is click here and kind of start it right at 26 minutes. Just start it there at 26 minutes and just hear that first question. Okay, the first question that Jimmy gets is about lift. Okay. Lift is something that they try to avoid in the cars, but they still get it. So how do they avoid that lift, that air coming up? Okay, so that just that first question. Now this is a Google Hangout, and then it'll simulate kind of what to expect as you're going through the program, and you do have the opportunity to connect your students into a hangout with Jimmy. But for right now, just those first 3 minutes after minute 26 or 27. Okay, so you'll probably have to fast forward the video if it doesn't start right where you want it, up to minute 26. So kind of right about there. You'll notice it says 26. Okay, and fast forward it. And just watch that first question. Now, here are the questions that are highlighted for you guys to think about. What is lift, Bernoulli's principle, how does it affect the car? And what you do is you write here your answer and you submit it, and then I'll be able to see it. If we go back to all the steps and we go into exploring and learning about lift, then there's readings about what is lift and some of the incorrect theories about lift, about how lift is created. And then there's a video then about downforce and how downforce is used, how is it created, again, using the differences in pressure to get downforce, and how does it apply to cars? Again, here are the questions, and all you have to guys do is just simply answer them. Like, you can even do it as downforce, and then write your answer, and just submit the evidence, okay? The badge has 5 parts. This third part we're doing right now. So I'm gonna give you guys a time to do part 1 and part 2. When we reconnect, that'll be that third part. And then the fourth part is doing a little video, which is you guys, the opportunity for you guys to go through one of the activities that we're gonna be touching on when we reconnect, and maybe walking through it on your own. And the idea is for you guys to either grab a phone or something, maybe explain to me what we did with the airfoil. We're gonna be doing activities with ping pong ball. So just walking through how you would do that. I know that Terry has some set up for you guys for later to go through that recording, but it's a short recording, no more than 3 minutes. It's just giving you an opportunity to kind of talk through how you would teach this and how to explain what is happening. And then at the end, just submit a lesson plan. You can use your own structure that you use. If not, the one that NASA uses is the 5E portion. But it's up to you guys how you want to structure it. And those parts, you're going to be given time today to finish them up. And you'll receive 6 hours of professional development once you finish that. So I'm going to leave you guys now to ponder about what we talked about, go into the badge, investigate a little bit more. When we reconnect, again, you guys are going to be working in teams. I'm going to assign you guys some roles and some specific jobs that you have to do on your roles. And then we're going to be doing the hands-on activities, so using some ping pong balls, index cards, and trying to figure out how to best manipulate those materials using either Bernoulli's principle or Venturi's principle. Venturi's effect, what Venturi effect means is when you squeeze a fluid, it'll make it go faster. So we know that once you have a fluid going really fast, you'll have a lower pressure. So it still applies if you mix in now Bernoulli's principle with faster moving fluids, lower pressure, then you can manipulate and try to get that net force to work in your favor. Okay? Are there any questions? Okay, so what I would suggest. Oh, sorry, yep.
So for the working through the badge, do you have a time frame that you'd like? Because I'm thinking mute our side while we work on that, correct? And
yes.
Then is there a particular time that you're thinking to maybe reconnect?
So at 11:30 is what I'm thinking. Because the studio, I'm in a studio, if you notice, I have a beautiful background for you guys and everything. The studio will be used at 1 o'clock my time, noon. I said 11, so 10:30 your time,
okay,
to noon, correct? 11:30 my time till 1.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So right now it's 9. So at 10:30, if we can come back in, start the discussion, and then start with the projects, I think that'll work best.
Okay, that sounds good.
Okay, so what I'm going to do is mute everything here. I'll just stay connected because once connected, I don't want to ruin it, right? If it's working, don't fix it. but if you do have any questions or anything, you can email me or send it through the badge, okay, guys? But I'll be in and out from the studio to my office. Okay? Okay, so I'll see you at 10:30 your time.
Anybody have any trouble getting into badges?
Well, it was really fast. I was trying to pay attention and look at, you know, the things at all. Did anyone not get the...
Yeah.
Okay. I did the first two.
Okay.
You want free time?
No, 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 that's good. I mean,
I would say at this point explore the other things because you gotta be here.
That app,
and just look and see what else, because that's something we, the way this is set up is that we will implement one this year, the end of the year, and then next year we will implement a total of four. So whatever we choose to put together this year and tweak and mess with, we're just starting, and then we could add
so maybe we should look at the
three
teams,
more
the teams that we have to teach the rest of the year.
See if there's something else. So that's I have not explored a lot of it, but you've talked through almost the whole year now. So you know what's there, and
so what do we have left to teach and have
to apply here? More than eighth grade, but yeah, there's space, but if there's a little bit of life science, but
maybe
space too.
Maybe,
which, not saying that we couldn't, you know, that this is, I don't want y'all to fit a square peg into a round hole. It doesn't fit. But, and there are others, I mean, because we have our most of what's in science from 6 through 8. But just look to see if there's anything that goes more with what our standards are. And I did that just to let you know that wind tunnel app, you can get it on the phone too. And it's free because I'd love to see.
Do you guys want me to see if I can, if y'all brought headphones or that would be the other thing? Some people like live with them and.
Yeah, I don't.
Okay, y'all, are we getting, if you don't have headphones and you want them to go through some of the badges, how many people, if I can get any, that's an if, how many people would want headphones? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. I don't know that I can get them, but I would rather go at least come in and do that.
Worst question do you get?
Can we use it in our math class? But I can't.
Frontier.
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 Okay, a couple of things, guys. Headphones. Headphones, who else?
Yay, thank you.
Yay. Anyone else? That's the last two, y'all. No, it's okay, but they're the last two. Okay, while we're interrupted, I would like to introduce Mike Zizzo, and he is from Texas Motor Speedway. And so he has a few things that he'd like to say to you guys while we're kind of in the lull in the badge work. So
I'll just take a couple of minutes. First off, I want to thank everyone for participating in the Rockets race. We're very excited about it, the program, and we can't wait to hear your feedback from the student and build a nice foundation for the future here in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. We know how difficult it is to add something like this to your curriculum in the middle of the year. They really wanted to get it started. We appreciate Northwest ISD helping us out on that front. So, in appreciation, each of our instructors will get two tickets to the Duck Commander 500 to see Jimmy race, but also his Q&A portion that'll be before the race for only the Rockets to Race Car folks. You'll take part in that as well. And then we're also gonna give two sets of tickets to the top two students in each of your classes. So you'll select who that is. And it's about a $200-$250 value on those tickets. So you'll have great seats. You'll get to see Jimmy. Have a great time. And like I said, we just appreciate what you're doing educationally and also for Jimmy's program. So thank you.
Thank you. There you go. Bye. See you later. See, there you go. You didn't know you were going to get that today. Y'all were just thinking I could see you off camera.
Thank you. treasurer. Thank you. Just
Here we would be power strips at some point.
Yeah.
Okay, wow.
They are going to want some feedback. So if we try it, you know, this year, then we'll see. And better, since it's a pilot, then you want feedback. That's a good thing. Towards where we have right now, what's in the beginning. That doesn't mean the next year our scope and sequence is going to shift a little bit late. Just because second 6 weeks is like. So.
I will.
Just like
the
two
lock.
Yes.
I think I have pictures somewhere.
Oh, okay.
I do.
That's up to you. They're not a choice.
Which they have to look at this is just the most important.
This is the first time I've been able to make sure I'm fine. So the first couple of days when I did this, you know, I know I saw the students from something. The answer I got was, so if I force them, I don't come back. This is what I think of. Go ahead and run it.
But even the wing is only about the wouldn't the wing in the back then be kind of
But they don't readjust traffic. No, because you got the air up and you got the air coming too in the front. That's what we need to go back. You push down, it's catching all that other stuff. But if it's in the brush,
You know, like an overlook of stuff.
Oh, those are the dirt track.
So I think that maybe it's, or you may have an elementary that
We didn't know because they probably want us
ready. And now I don't know what I was just
tell him. Throw your weight in there. Throw your name in there if that's what helps. Because this is what they told me. And we're interested in doing this. However, this is kind of cost prohibitive. Was there?
Yeah.
That's cost prohibitive. So. Right, exactly. I just said that you don't find class are interested in co-piloting, or is there another way that we can, because I work in, that's just, so that word cost prohibitive.
Is that what they're
I don't know, and that's another thing we could look at to keep you posted on this if you are using the.
I'll just discuss that. Absolutely.
Yeah, and we're excited about this. Let's see.
Still, just now heard back.
Right.
And you email then. I just know heads. Never heard.
I would say try if you're that interested, see me on it and let's see. You might even be, or some of his contacts might be capable of bringing him as speakers or people to do sessions every day. So that's another thing. We're putting that together right now. And so maybe a connection with him, somebody might be some in their guest speakers if you wanted them to do like a group session, maybe them for science or whatever, or do several presentations throughout the day. And that might be an option as well. But that was 1 day a week.
Yeah.
My dad is a Navy pilot. He always played in the planes, flew airplanes, passed through the top.
Oh no, I didn't do that. Because it's what we need to do.
But I mean, that also
that's the other thing. Oh, we get copied in here.
It was too soon.
Yeah, I copied this over. I think it must be. So I mean, we need to cut you in that room.
I had this guy, and I was just waiting for the day. I didn't think it mattered too much. So she's here.
No. No.
So we talked today about it. She really just needed, she needed permission to let one of our other friends every once in a while.
Like the whole car, like the whole parking lot.
And so a lot of them
yeah.
have to leave their homes.
Oh my gosh, I'm so
bad. And it's just bad. It's really Texas is so hard. The rains are so dry and spread out.
And that's what topic it is.
It's a good thing.
Okay,
so, maybe should we get excited?
Hey, everybody, check out.
Okay, everybody, how are we doing?
Hi. It's raining here, so the sound quality.
Yeah. We may need you to speak up a lot. It's pouring here. We can you can hear it. We have a lot of external sound, so.
Okay.
Okay.
How is everybody doing so far?
Okay. If you notice, I got some cool stuff for you guys now. So this is a model. This happens to be that somebody walked through a model, and I asked them, "Can I have it for a little bit to show you guys?" So this is the SLS rocket.
Okay.
The Space Launch System, SLS. Okay, this is the new rocket that we're working on. If you think, this is why we're all zoomed out so you can see it. It's 1/100 scale, the size. This is the one that's gonna be larger than the Empire State Building. Okay, this is the new rocket that we're working on. If you think about it, the space shuttle was the tractor trailer. If you remember, the space shuttle grabbed inside of it, had all the parts for the International Space Station. And just like a tractor trailer, it hauled everything up into the exosphere. So the International Space Station is still within Earth's atmosphere. It's right in that last layer of our atmosphere. It's designed that way so that we can still protect the astronauts from radiation, but we have the microgravity. So 10^-6 times the amount of gravity than we have here on Earth. So it makes it a laboratory in space. And the space shuttle carried every single part up. So it took about 10 years, right, to build the International Space Station. It's the size of a football field. And now that that is done, we're building our Mustang. It's kind of how I like to say it. We went from a tractor trailer now to the Mustang. And this is our Mustang, which is going to take us to the moon, to Mars, to an asteroid, to any type of mission. Now, if you notice, I'm going to walk to the model. This is real scale, and it's made. Let me take this off. So it has all the realistic components of it. So if I take this off, okay, right here, this is the space capsule. This is where the astronauts are in. This is
the new Orion space capsule. All of this is needed to get out of from the pool of Earth's gravity. Everything that's going to space is this little part.
Wow.
Significant, right? Okay. Wait, I need to put this together again, how it goes. But think of it. Think of the mass, right? That's why we always talk about mass, not necessarily weight. Another cool thing is you guys are going into different planets, talking about the solar system. Okay, so we always talk about mass and how much mass are we carrying in either component, because the weight is going to be different, especially as we arrive to Mars, right? So this is to get us out of Earth's gravity, and then all these different parts, components, this keeps breaking down into components to get us into orbit and to get us up to the speed that we need to arrive to Mars. This is the first part that flies off. This is the launch abort system, designed here at NASA Langley, so that if anything happens to the astronauts, they're shot away from all this explosive device, right? So that goes. And then one of the sessions, right, we were talking about that we're going to be doing four topics today is aero. One of the sessions is the human impact and G-forces, which drivers and astronauts experience those G-forces very much. This would be 11 Gs or 11 times your weight is what the astronauts experience in half a second, but it gets them out of harm's way. And then the capsule keeps going with these little components, okay? And then once it lands, this is the part that lands, and once it hits the atmosphere, it's just this part that then lands on Mars. So if you notice, look at the design, and again, there are some designs in the app where you can simulate what happens when you have a shape like this, okay? So if you notice, you guys went through the badge. So the first video and all the videos really talked about lift, but it also pointed about drag. So what is drag? I want to ask you guys, what is drag?
The resistance to the lift.
Right, okay. So drag, so it's not, let's think about it. It goes against lift, but keep in mind that it's not opposite of lift. Okay, so it works against lift, but it's not the opposite force of lift. When you're trying to move forward,
the opposite is drag.
Okay, when we're talking about lift, we're talking about 90 degrees from your component of where you're trying to go. So lift, if I'm the airplane and I'm moving forward, this is thrust, completely opposite is drag, and then lift is up. It's always 3 degrees from thrust, okay? So yes, it'll ruin or it'll play against your lift, but just keep in mind that that could be a misconception on how you present it when you're talking about the forces that act literally against. Okay, because you're trying to move against, you're trying to move all those air molecules, and that's drag, always pushing you back. Now, when we design things to land in other atmospheres, we use drag to slow us down. So if you do have a chance to walk or watch that Google Hangout with Jill Prince and Jimmy, I asked you guys to just watch a little bit, but Jill starts the show, and she has landed various rovers on Mars. She has been a team of engineers responsible for landing, and she talks about how drag is not necessarily a drag like it is for Jimmy. It's actually a good thing, and why the shapes, if you notice, the shape is very wide, to use drag and to spread out the energy, because as you're hitting things, what type of energy
What type of force is acting right there?
Friction.
When you clap your hands?
Friction.
Yeah, friction.
Friction, right? And friction generates?
Heat.
Okay. So a shape like this will spread the heat out, so it's not concentrated in one point versus someone like the X-Wing fighters, they have a lot of tips. You know, Star Wars and the all those ships and stuff, they have a lot of tips. What happens with tips, though, is that all that heat will concentrate in one tip. And now you'll probably have to, that tip will probably melt or will snap off. So when you look at things that are going into space and going through other atmospheres, it'll be very smooth to combat that energy. Okay, so now we're talking about forces and energy, types of energy, energy dispersion. Okay, does that make sense?
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay. So let me show you guys other examples, because I heard space, okay? I heard space and you guys said space, so I want to make sure that we touch on that quickly. So let me show you guys the pictures, okay? So we've been very successful at landing things on Mars, but it's actually really difficult to do, right? And it's not like we want to land anywhere on Mars. We really have a pinpoint where we want to be. So engineers need to have the precision as if you were in New York City and you had a basketball and you were to throw it to get nothing but the hoop, or nothing but the net, sorry, but the hoop is in San Francisco. That's the type of precision these engineers need to have when landing things on Mars or another planet. Let me show you guys here the progression of the sizes of the rover. So when we explore, we first send a kind of like a satellite that just flies by, and we call it a flyby, and takes pictures just to see what's out there. Do you guys think of anything that we just sent that flew by and took pictures?
Oh yeah,
that's right. We just got the first pictures of Pluto. We've never seen Pluto, guys, until July of last year. We've never seen it. We've only had ideas of what Pluto might be, even the color, right? But we sent New Horizons, which is the fastest spacecraft that we've sent. Okay, it took a long time, really, to get out there. And think of the distance, now that you guys are gonna be talking about the solar system, right? It took about 9 hours for any signal to go one way or the other. So New Horizons was taking pictures as it flew by Pluto, and now we have awesome pictures. We know the actual color of Pluto. We know that it has mountains similar to the ones here near me, the Blue Ridge Mountains. So they're not as high as the Rocky Mountains, but they're still pretty tall mountains, especially for something that we thought was geologically dead. But that evidence of having these huge mountains means that it's, in a way, geologically alive or more newer than our moon. Okay, so that's really interesting, and that's really a lot, one of the many things that scientists are looking at now, looking at those images. Okay. But we flew by it and we took pictures. Now those pictures, it took 9 hours for those pictures to get to Earth and be able to be downloaded. So if you want to talk about time lag because of distance. So we fly by, then we send, if it's something of interest, then we send another spacecraft to orbit or go around the object of interest. And once we learn more and we look at different areas, we can pick where to land best. We know how to land, what to expect, or best guesses. And then we send rovers or landers. So landers, it just lands and it stays there. rovers have the ability to move around and study more than just where they landed. So that's where we've been at Mars. So we're getting ready to send humans to Mars by 2030 or 2033. So we're working on that. So if you notice the progression of the sizes of the rovers, the first rover is the one in the bottom left, sent in 1997, Sojourner, is the size of a microwave. That was the first one, first rover to land there. Then the second ones are the ones to the left of the people in the picture, which were the twin rovers, the Spirit and Opportunity, and they're more the size of a golf cart. And they just bounced on Mars. But because of that technology in early 2000s, here on Earth, we got airbags in our cars, because how they landed was basically using airbags. So a lot of the technology developed for space or for astronauts, you'll see here on Earth. And then the latest one, or the last one that we've sent, is Curiosity, which is to the right of the people there, is the size of a minivan. Okay? So for each one, there has to be a different way to land it. And how important is an atmosphere? So for you guys, does Mars have an atmosphere?
Yes.
Do you guys know how does it compare to here on Earth, to the one here on Earth?
Can you repeat that, Marilé? We're having a little bit of breakup. Can you repeat that for us?
No problem. How does Mars' atmosphere compare to here on Earth?
Yeah.
It's thinner. Yes, I think I heard thinner. So remember, whenever we explore, we always compare to what we know, which is Earth. So that's another interesting thing of Earth science. What we learn about Earth gives us an idea of what are we looking at as we're exploring other bodies, other planets, other moons. Okay, as we're taking pictures, we can say if something was formed by water, if something was formed by wind, if something was volcanic. Okay, so just keep that in mind. So Mars' atmosphere is 100 times thinner. So I didn't tell you guys, but my background is atmospheric sciences. So I studied climate and weather. I think you noticed a little bit when I was talking about air parcels and things expanding and creating tornadoes and stuff like that. That is my passion. I am from the Caribbean, so I do a lot of more hurricanes. Okay, so when we're talking about Bernoulli, I always think about hurricanes, because when you hear about hurricanes, you have pressure and wind information, and you see how the hurricane gets stronger as the pressure decreases. So that's really neat correlation with something that affects some of part of the country, right? But it's data that you'll see in when you're talking about weather. Okay, so Mars' atmosphere is 100 times thinner. So at sea level here on Earth, the pressure is 1,013 millibars. On Mars, it's about 6 millibars at sea level. So it's very, very thin, but we still have to consider it when we're landing on Mars. So the designs of things have to take account that you will develop friction, enough friction, that it could break your systems, your spacecraft, if you're not careful. But it gives us the opportunity of using the atmosphere to slow down. So I want to show you guys some neat videos that you can use in the classroom about this topic. This one I'm going to show you guys just a little bit, but it's how hard is it really to land anything on Mars?
The people looking,
three.
pocket and we'll mess with it.
Okay, so I know it's a very tense video. I hope you guys liked it. But it goes into how we use aerodynamics even on Mars or in different planets. There is a shorter video that goes into that, and it just takes 1 minute. And it's called Mars in a Minute. Yes.
Harley, just see everything on that, but we couldn't hear.
Oh, you can't hear it? I'm sorry. I apologize.
Oh, it's okay. When the video was playing, I wasn't sure that once it was going, if you would hear us let you know that. But it was, I mean, it's interesting. We can see everything, but we just can't hear some of his voice. But it seemed like he was talking from a tunnel maybe, so we couldn't really understand. But I don't know if there's anything to adjust.
So thank you for that feedback. What I'll do is I'll send you all the links to the videos. It kind of touches on how difficult it is to land. And when we land humans, we have to land much more mass than with this latest rover. Okay, with this latest rover, when you talk to the engineers here at NASA Langley that were responsible for it, they'll tell you that they pulled every trick out of the book, okay, even out of their sleeves. So there is still a lot of challenges in landing humans on Mars because the payload, the mass is going to be so much bigger. Okay, but it's just some ways on how we're working now through flight or navigation. So when you look at that small chunk of video, what he says is that there's drag. Because of the friction, it gets to 1500 degrees Celsius. It shines like the sun. And it's going through all that drag, but at the same time, you have to fly like an airplane to make sure that it lands where you want it to land. And that's particularly true when we send humans on Mars. Okay. So I wanna go back, I'll send you guys all the links to the videos. And as you're going through developing ideas for your lesson plans, please be sure to talk to me because there might be other videos that tie very nicely to what you would like to do, okay? So we talked about drag, we talked about lift. What is downforce? I want to ask you guys, what did you learn downforce is?
The air pushes down on the car.
Okay, so very good. So if we have a principle like what we talked about with the airfoil, and we turned it upside down, then you have downforce. Okay, so let's walk through that again. I'm gonna draw the airfoil, right? Now, what are the things that work with the airfoil? Is that with the shape, one side of the airfoil, you'll have faster moving air compared to the other side of the airfoil, and that'll lead to that difference in pressure, and you'll create lift. Now, you guys read one of the biggest misconceptions about why air goes faster over that curve. So what is the correct reasoning behind why does the air go faster around a curve?
Is it less resistance?
Oh, the distance traveled?
So whenever you squeeze a fluid or you force it around a curve, it'll go faster, right? The biggest misconception is that it goes faster because it is a longer path, okay? But it's not like the air molecules say, oh no, I need to catch up with Tom at the end of this shape. I better start going fast because Jill, who's already at the end, told me that this is a longer distance, okay? But if you think about it, atmospheric sciences, so the study of how air moves and how things behave in our atmosphere, is relatively new. It really started with the World War I and especially World War II with the airplanes. Okay, so it's very recent compared to other sciences like biology or physics. Okay, this is physics applied to the atmosphere. So thanks to observations and tests through wind tunnels, we have a better understanding of what is happening. So let's go through that again. I'm going to draw with you guys, and if you guys want to follow me along. I'm going to start my camera here again, my document camera. We talked about the airfoil shape, curved on one surface and flat on the other. So what happens when you force a fluid around a curve?
It moves faster.
It goes faster, okay? And it goes faster relative to the bottom, the air going to the bottom. Now, what does Bernoulli tell you? Can you say that a little bit louder?
Slower.
If it's slower, there's more pressure. I thought it was faster moving fluids exert less pressure.
Okay, so it's faster, slower,
less.
Slower, more.
Yeah.
I see you making sure. Just saying.
Okay, so which one do you guys want to do, fast or slow?
Fast.
Okay, so if I have faster moving air, what does Bernoulli tell me about the pressure?
Low pressure.
So then I'll have low pressure. Because I have slower moving air, I'll have high pressure. And let's see if this makes sense, okay? So we know that with this shape, what is the net force that I'm gonna have?
Force.
Right? And it has to point up. So high pressure means that I have a lot of air molecules on that side. So right now we wrote the high pressure on the bottom. So I'm gonna draw, just stay with me here, right? But let's think that that's air molecules. So I should have more on the bottom and just a few on the top. And all these air molecules are hitting the surface. So does this make sense?
Yes.
Okay. So the area where it has most of the air molecules is going to be pushing towards the area where there's less air molecules. Everything in nature goes from high to low. If you look at osmosis, it goes from where there's a lot of water to where there's very little water. If you look at pressure systems or storms,
winds go from high pressure to low pressure. Okay, everything goes from high to low. Air in our atmosphere, the pressure in our atmosphere, how does it behave as you move up in altitude? What does it happen? Sorry?
As you increase in altitude, there are fewer air molecules.
That's right. Okay, so pressure decreases with height. Everything goes from high to low. Okay. So now we have lift, right? Somebody tells me. We know that when you force a fluid around a curve or you squeeze a fluid, it'll go faster. And Bernoulli's principle states that whenever you have faster moving fluid or air, you'll have a lower pressure. Now, what happens if I just turn it around? Where do I have my faster moving air?
On the bottom.
On the bottom, right? Because I'm forcing the air around the curve. So where is my low pressure?
On
the bottom. My high pressure on the top. So what is my net force? Where does it point?
Down.
Down. Okay. This is called down force. And that's what's used in race cars particularly. If you notice, the shape is actually a spoiler in the back of the car. So when you look at, let's say, Jimmy's car, you notice the back, he has a spoiler. Before it actually looked like the wing in the early designs of the stock car. Now it more looks like, kind of like something like this in the back of the car. But what it's producing is high and low pressures so that it gets downforce on the back of the car. I'm looking for pictures here of the car. Let me share the PowerPoint. So when we look at a stock car, and if you notice the back here, that is the spoiler. And that spoiler in the back of the car is what will create that downforce down, okay? It'll create lower moving speeds on the top, higher moving speeds in the bottom, and it'll push the car down to make sure that the car stays on the surface, on the track surface, so it can go faster. Okay. Now, when we look at the front of the car, there's something different there. What is happening in the front of the car?
It's a splitter.
Can you say that again? Sorry?
Splitter.
The splitter. That's right. Okay. And what is the job of the splitter?
Reduce lift.
Right. So it still uses downforce. It still creates downforce so that you don't have lift. Let me go here. Here's a picture of the splitter. Okay. You can barely put your fingers under the car once it's ready to roll. Here's another design here. So what's happening with the air going under the car? Is there a lot of it or very little of it? Let me collect the iPad here. The splitter splits the air, right? It splits the air. So that most of it goes over the car and some of it goes under the car. And as it splits, it squeezes. What did we talk about when you squeeze a fluid?
Faster.
It goes faster. So let me go into the app and let's look at what's happening. Okay. Let me make sure that this. Sorry, guys, I'm connecting the iPad and making sure that you guys can see it.
On the other side of the screen, not in the space.
Right.
So the pressure on the outside is. So it doesn't it's fast, slow. So it's not low pressure. But it does slow down on the other side of the space.
Okay.
But if it's going slow, then it has high pressure. So the air.
Let me try it one more time. Let me show you guys. It's not connecting, but. If you notice, the blue colors are faster moving speeds. Let me make sure that I have, let me put speeds. Okay, so you have red right there, faster moving speeds. Okay, so whenever you squeeze a fluid, you get faster moving speeds. So just looking up here in the front of the car, you have slower moving speeds compared to higher moving speeds, especially if you increase the splitter. Now, if you buy the, if you purchase the other version, you can draw your own shapes. Maybe you can draw your splitter. But if you have lower moving speeds up top, what type of pressure would that cause?
Higher pressure.
So slower moving speeds just means that you'll have a lot of air molecules in that area at a particular time. So if you have slower moving speeds, you'll have more molecules, which will lead to what type of pressure?
High pressure.
High pressure. In the bottom, you have faster moving speeds. So if you take a snapshot in the second, you'll have fewer air molecules in the bottom. What type of pressure would you have?
Low pressure.
Low pressure, okay? So everything goes from high to low. That is downforce in the front due to the splitter of the car. In the back, you have downforce due to the spoiler. And it's called a spoiler. Does anybody know why a spoiler is called a spoiler?
Spoils lift?
Yes, very good. It spoils lift. Okay. And it's in that video, that really cool video of, from the National Science Foundation. Okay. Oops, sorry. Okay, so very good, guys. So in the app, that's why I like this app, because you can change from different shapes. You can look at a plate and just look at how a plate looks. There's different options. And you can go into speed, look at speed, or look at pressure and see if it correlates. Right? Higher pressure, lower speeds, lower pressure, faster speeds, okay? So you can bounce what I'm doing. There's a little plus here in the bottom, which opens the menu, and it lets me look between just looking at air, the particles and how it would behave, smoke, pressure, and speed. Okay, so I've been showing you guys the speed and pressure. So it's a really neat way to see that. And you can ask your students to compare and contrast what are their observations. Okay, so lift and downforce are the same,
It's just where it's pointing at. If it's pointing at up, we call it lift. If it's pointing down, we call it downforce. That's the main difference. And it's all because we want that imbalance in forces using pressure. Okay, and that it's called the pressure gradient force, if you would like to know that. But it's that change in pressure that leads to either lift or downforce. So I want you guys, I'm going to divide you guys up now into teams, and we're going to tackle a few challenges. Let me get here the pictures. So each team, I think there's 12 of you guys, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. So there's 5 roles. Now, you don't need 5 people in your team. You can have one person have 2 roles. And at NASA, we do that a lot. If you think of astronauts, some of the astronauts are also engineers or are also medical doctors or are also teachers, okay? So I'll list 5 roles, but if you wanna do 3 teams of 4 people, that would be great. And I want you guys, if you want, figure out which teams are you going to be in before I talk about the roles and responsibilities. So figure out what 4, if you're a person, what other 3 people are you going to work with?
I know good packing people combining, and then we'll keep it the way we're sitting at tables. I think we got it. We're going to go. We got it.
You got it? Okay. So here are the roles. Somebody in the team should be a designer. And here's an actual designer here at NASA Langley, Tim Marvel, and he does a lot of 3D animations. If you could be the best researcher, best scientist, best engineer, but if you don't have a way to really show what you're finding or what you're trying to accomplish with the help of an animator or designer, you're not going to go very far. So I want somebody to be a designer. And the designer's going to draw kind of just how we did with the airfoil. The designer for that team is going to draw out how the experiment is going to look at, and if needed, a before and after. So we're going to be going through some challenges, and the designer's job is then to draw out kind of the setup. Somebody needs to be a pilot. And here is Commander Eileen Collins, an instructor pilot. We have a lot of pilots at NASA. And the pilot is going to look at what are the forces that are acting on. So we were looking at where's the pressure differences and what is the net force and what is the name of that force. So we were talking about if it's pointing up, if that net force is pointing up, it'll be lift. If it's pointing down, it'll be downforce. So the pilot's job is to figure out what is the net force and where is it pointing at. The next one is the scientist. And here I have example Adriano Campo, who's a planetary geologist, which is really cool, looking at geology on different planets. And she is one of the leads for the Juno mission, which is about to reach Jupiter here. In July of this year. So the scientist's job, I want the scientists to figure out where the high and low pressures are located in the experiments to help out the pilot figure out where is the net force. Okay, so where the high and low pressures are located. I'm gonna need a driver as well. I have here, of course, Jimmy. He is the master of aerodynamics in the 48 team. And again, just like the pilot, the driver, the importance of being a really good driver is being able to feel what is happening, just like the pilot feels what's happening with the airplane and being able to adjust. So with the driver and pilots, figure out where is the net force and what force is being applied. So is it lift? Is it downforce? Is it drag? Then I want an engineer in the team. And here I have Babak Ferdowsi. He's a systems engineer. You probably have seen him in the landing, the entry, descent, and landing of the Mars rovers. Okay, and what I would like the engineers to figure out how the air is going to move around the object or the experiment. And if you guys have your iPads, you can use that as a reference as well. So do we have the roles assigned?
Yep.
Okay, and do you guys understand the responsibilities of each role?
I think we got it.
Okay, perfect. So let's do the first one and we'll do this together, okay? I'm gonna grab a piece of paper. I'm gonna roll it up a little bit. And I'll show you the setup for my graphic designers, right? The graphic designer is gonna draw the setup and if necessary, a before and after. So two drawings so you can discuss what happened before and what happened after. So I've rolled up the piece of paper. I'm gonna put it in the bottom right below my lip. Now I'm a flutist as well. So any flutists in the room? No flutists? Oh my gosh. Anybody instruments?
I did, yeah.
What do you play?
Well, I played the flute.
Okay. Awesome. And then the back?
Was clarinet. That
what do you play?
Clarinet.
Oh, clarinet. Very good. Okay.
Clarinet.
Awesome. The clarinet is a little bit different because you have the... Oh, what is that? See, my brain is thinking in Spanish because I've only been in the States for about 10 years, so all my musical training was in Spanish, if you think about it. So my brain doesn't go into flats and sharps. It goes into Spanish. But you have the bamboo, right, with the clarinet? So with the paper, you're going to put it under your lip.
Okay.
Okay. Now, what is the setup? You're going to put it under your lip. And if I blow air over it, what will happen?
Low pressure, high speed.
So I want you guys to go through the design first before you test it, guys. Have your graphic designer draw the setup. Okay. Draw the setup. The engineer will add the flow. Where will the air flow? Once you have that, then the scientist can figure out where the high and low pressure. And then the driver and pilots can figure out what will the net force or the net result will be. Okay. So again, you hold it under your lip. And the idea is that I'm going to blow straight across. I'm not going to blow down. I'm going to blow straight across. And for our flutists, that's pretty easy, right, guys? Straight. And what will happen?
Right. Yes, it is.
Okay.
So y'all know kids are going to want to do this. The trick is to get them to explain what happened and go back and show. Connect the learning with it.
So the paper when we're holding it, but the paper changes. It lifts up. Because on the app you can't create your own pressure. Yeah, the pressure is just constantly happening.
I don't know. That might be a good question to ask them. So I'll put that out in the way.
Let's
see.
That's a good question to ask.
Right.
I need a
So if it shows that, can you increase the speed? Or do you do that strictly with the shape?
Okay, so I'm going to give you guys about 2 more minutes, okay?
Okay, guys, so what is your initial discussion leading to?
Yeah, but beyond the kids will like it.
We're creating lift by increasing the speed of our molecules on top of the paper from blowing it.
Okay, so I heard that you're creating lift, right? Yes. So there's a few things that we're leading to it. I created a curve, right? What happens when you have a curved surface? You force a fluid around a curve. It goes faster, right? Now, what am I producing by blowing air?
A compression.
So I'm accelerating the air. So think of my mouth as the squeezing, right? I'm making the air go faster compared to the air on the bottom. So everything is in comparison, okay? So what would be the net result? Paper going up, right? Okay. So where is your high pressure?
Underneath.
Okay, so low pressure, high, it goes up. Now, one of the interesting things to note is it flat? Does it just stay flat when you do it?
No, it goes up and down and up and down.
Right? It flaps. And that's because of faster moving air will reach the end of the paper faster than slower moving air. Okay, so those are the vortices or the little circles, turbulence that you'll see at the end. When you look at the iPad, you'll see at the end of the airfoil shape, you'll see it around the curves. If you pick the river, if you want to look at the river, okay? That is one of the biggest things we observe with the wind tunnel, is that the air doesn't
reach the end of the shape at the same time. It's one of the things that we broke with that misconception through observations, is that the air doesn't catch up at the end of the shape at the same time. Okay, the air that goes faster will reach the end of the shape faster than the air on the bottom. And if you use the iPad, you can look at that when you just load the shape again and you'll have the air moving through it. You'll see how it moves with that initial state. So you'll notice the movement when you're starting up the app and you pick either speed or pressure. You'll see that in action. Okay, so are you guys ready for your tasks?
Yes.
And we're going to be using the teams now. The first task is, I want you guys, you should have ping pong balls, so I want you guys per team at least to grab one ping pong ball, and I see Terry, so I'm gonna give her some time. Your task is to grab one ping pong ball and one straw. And you should guys have flexi straws. Wanna make sure that you guys have flexi straws?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, perfect. Your job as a team, just like similar to how we did with the paper, is figure out a way to maintain the ping pong ball elevated or in midair the longest, or suspended in air. So your job is to use a ping pong ball and a straw and try to suspend the ping pong ball in air. Okay, so use your team, draw out the best setup for this, figure out how the air is moving around, look at the shape that you're using and figure out what will happen. What is happening to maintain that ping pong ball suspended in the air? Okay. So I'll give you a little bit of time so you figure out that in your team.
There's more if you want. Well, and there's another variable. So I'm drawing these little balls. Dimples.
How fast is
the black and white ones are dimples. Yeah, exactly. And then that's the difference. So we have dimples.
I'm
low
enough.
So if your car has hail damage.
Well, have you not seen the car? If we have low pressure, what? Yeah, you can get off the
car.
Okay, so it
introduces
the
press.
And so it's
mild. Okay, so that's the other thing we're doing. But you're already, that's what you're going to get asked. This is how we want the kids to be also to know if we're going to be in there. There's more of everything.
You
have the. No. You have to come back around here.
In the little bucket up there with the lid on. Yes.
Those are, I don't know if they're the same mask. That's another thing to consider because I don't know if they're the same or not.
We're all kind of doing the wrong experiment, but and then y'all can discuss if this is
better. Well, slower than the strong, you can have higher critical volume, which is obviously going to come at the breath, and then that way it'll push cards. The faster you
Oh, did you see what it did to the thing? I mean, the fact that it's black and white, you can really see what it's doing because I think you might miss that it's all white. But it's been
colored. Okay, guys, so have you worked through what is happening and what is the best design?
You have an idea?
I'm interested to see your drawing where the pressures are.
We have to get some feedback, y'all. Okay, so white. We're working on white.
So is there a team that has their drawing?
No.
We're still playing.
Okay, we have other tasks to do, so let's make sure you guys understand what's happening. Okay. Yeah, Michael that raised his hand. I'm trying to remember.
Yeah, we have a drawing.
You have a drawing? If you want to bring it up and put it in front of the camera, I can see it.
It's a little.
No, that's not the camera.
Where's the camera? Oh, here's the
camera. Yeah, there you go. Okay, so lower it a little bit. Okay, so very good. So there is gravity and you're pushing, right? Now, where is the low pressure? So you're saying that the low pressure is.
Well, we want to go slowly to get a higher pressure on the bottom, the lower pressure
at
the top.
Okay, so very good. So I want you guys, this is a very great start, okay? So go back and try this. Now, if you guys have noticed when you were playing, the ball kind of swivels.
Yeah.
If you notice,
okay?
What is making it not fall, or what is making it swivel?
The pressure, the air pressure.
Okay, right, so it's the air pressure. So instead of thinking microscopic, let's think macroscopic. If you think of the air out here versus the air right here, where is the high and low pressure in that scenario?
Okay.
So the drawing is really good, but it's looking at it's like a snapshot really zoomed in. So I'm asking you guys now to zoom out and think of what is happening with the surrounding air versus the air right around the ping pong ball. And remember, this is a shape, look at the shape, and you do have in your iPad and your and the iPad app, which I'm trying to get a fix, you do have a circle so you can see what is happening. And one of the options, again, this is a free version, there is a circle there. So what is happening between the air all around and the air right at the ping pong ball? Okay.
Can you see this? This is what we're thinking. We're thinking there are basically two circles.
Okay.
Can you see that?
Yeah, can you put it really close and I can see it?
So we think that there's like two circles, basically. The area right around the ball, which is a low pressure system.
That's right. Very good.
Right at the very top of the ball, opposite of the straw air, is also a high pressure. And then there's a circle around the low pressure that's a high pressure.
Very good. Okay. So, very good. That's a really good drawing, too. So what is happening?
Okay, so she's explaining now, we want to know.
No, but you guys are getting to the right point, okay? And this is really good. There is a high pressure, which is Michael's team pointed out, right here, right? Because you're putting all that air to push that ball up. So there is a high pressure there. And there is kind of like a higher pressure out here, which... Sheila?
Yes.
Oh my gosh, okay. I took really good notes. I'm looking here. Okay, Sheila pointed out as well. Now, what makes it stay right there and wobble is that you have a circle. What happens when you force air around a curve? It goes faster. Okay, but now you have two curves, right? Because it's a sphere. So faster moving air. So you have low pressures on the sides of the ping pong ball. Now, if you zoom out, what is happening out here? Is that faster moving air compared to the ping pong ball or slower moving air right here where my hand is?
Slower. High pressure out there.
High to low. So when you see that wobble, is that high pressure from both sides pushing the ping pong ball to stay in the airstream. Okay? So that's what I meant by zooming in and zooming out. So all you guys' answers are true. They're just zoomed in. Once you start zooming out and you see the big picture, then you notice how there's other forces, and this is true in nature. There's things that are microscopic and the things that are macroscopic. And sometimes the things that are micro are the ones that are leading to the result that you see. And sometimes it's the bigger picture. Okay, when I think of weather, I think of fronts, or I think of parcels, and I think of the jet stream, right? The jet stream is a huge big picture. That's the biggest picture you can get. But sometimes just a small front can lead to a tornado. Okay, so micro and macro. So very good, guys, okay?
We lost the picture. We can't see you. We can hear you. I don't think it's on our ends. I'm working to see if it is.
But we it's just a blank screen to us.
Okay.
Let me. But I, that seems like a projector issue.
Okay.
There's no limit issue. Oh, yeah, it's giving me, hold on. It's our projector.
Okay, just let me know when you manage to get it going again.
Making the noise that the technology lights off. And it's blinking green. Okay, we have a steady. So maybe that needs to cool down. I know that we've had issues with this one before. Here, I think we're getting it back.
Okay, it's perfect.
There you are.
Yay! Okay, I'm still here. I'm still here with you guys. Okay, so what's happening is, let's draw it out. Let me go to my Elmo. We can draw it out together.
We're all having issues today, aren't we? Let me see over here. Okay, let me go back to me. If you notice in the app again, you have that circle and you can see the high. So if you imagine the straw is right here, it's pushing. So you have the high pressure right there and you have all these vortices coming out. Now, if you zoom out, you have low pressure on each side. If you zoom out here, it's high pressure. And high to low, it's pushing that ball to stay on top of the straw. Now, if you notice, if you reduced how strong you blow, then everything kind of went all over, right? And that happens as well with airplanes, because what happens as you go higher up in the atmosphere, what happens to the pressure?
Lower.
It decreases, right? So airplanes there's a certain altitude that just the airplanes and certain designs just don't work anymore. Even with, you have to increase your thrust moving forward or increase the length of your airfoil. So if anybody has ridden in an airplane or has been in an airplane near the wings, you'll notice that they'll extend the flaps to make the airfoil shape longer. They're trying to work around having less air moving through the object or around the object, because it's all dependent. So imagine Mars now. Mars is 100 times thinner. So objects like an airplane, which I have a picture here of an airplane that on Mars, a design of an airplane, kind of looks more like a glider than an actual airplane. And if you think of the high altitude airplanes, they have really big wingspans. They're trying to use as much gliding, if you will, possible to reach that lift, to stay in the air. Okay? So very good, guys. Let's try another one. Are you guys ready?
Yes.
Okay, so look at time. I want you guys to, you should have index cards. Okay. So one index card per team is fine. And I want you guys to fold it in a little bit of a different way. So try and fold it so it kind of looks like a splitter. And what I mean by that is that there's different ways that you can fold an index card. If you can try and fold it. It looks like a really, really, a table with really short legs. If you can try and fold it, right? Because the splitter is really close to the ground. So imagine that now, the idea with the splitter is the squeezing air underneath and letting, when you squeeze a fluid, what happens to that air? It'll move faster, okay? So with an index card and a straw, what is the design to try and get a splitter effect? So what is the force of the splitter? Is it lift or downforce?
Downforce.
Downforce, okay? So what is the setup to get downforce with this scenario? Okay, so draw it out. Figure out where the high and low pressures are with your scientists and the engineers at the flow. Where should your flow be to get downforce now?
Well, the whole shape of it, they said, was up in the horizontal. But the air is coming from here. So we're looking for something that creates a shape. So it's really just
It is moving down.
If you have a card like this,
and we can go show
the car. I knew this was going to be the place where it's taking down. How would you do it?
So the airflow is
in front.
Okay, guys, so do you have a setup?
So draw how much from the
that
one.
So remember, you're trying to get downforce. Use your straw and use the index card and try to fold it as a really, really low table and figure out where the flow should be to get downforce. I can see you, okay? Oh, that's perfect. Did it work?
Yep, yes.
Awesome. Okay, good job. Do you want to share it with the rest of your team or the other teams?
What's that? You want to share?
Yeah, share with
the Yeah, explain what is the design. How did you get it to get to use downforce?
Trial and error. Instead of going this way, I turned it, and I was thinking that it might have a tighter air flow, I guess, to squeeze it down a little more. I mean, I really just guessed.
Where's the
faster
air going?
Through the small space.
Yeah, the smaller the space, the air is going underneath it, so the faster air caused it to be sucked downwards.
Okay, so where did you put your straw to make the air go faster?
At the bottom?
Yeah. Small straw.
So very good. So
put it right in the front.
Get downforce, right? You need the faster air to be in the bottom to create that low pressure.
Right.
So you put your straw under it.
Yes.
So very good, guys. So this is really neat to review forces, right? And energy transfer, right? How when you're changing balances, you're creating a force or an acceleration, and then you create downforce. So it's really neat, okay? So you have to blow under. So you need to understand where you want your faster moving air and your slower moving air, okay? To create, and if you do it, you'll see that bent down. Okay. So very good, guys. Now, the other one that you can do, and I'll let you guys do it, is try to figure out a way to get two ping pong balls to come together. So once we disconnect, you guys can play around and figure out, as scientists, engineers, as a team, you're trying to figure out the best design to get two ping pong balls to come together. Where should your faster moving air be? Where should your slower moving air be? To use the pressure gradient force, or how pressure moves from high to low, how nature moves from where there's a lot to where there's little, okay? And the example here is that you do see when you see races, and especially Texas, when they're going on the straightaway, you'll see them come together. Why is that? What is happening? So instead of ping pong balls, now think of two cars. Now, we talked about how air is a fluid as well, so you'll see this also in ships. It happens in ships, how they come together. So I'll invite you guys, once we disconnect, to try and figure out what is happening and how to get those two ping pong balls to come together. Now, I want to hear you guys about the examples of lift or Bernoulli's principle or even downforce in your everyday lives. So what are some examples you thought about?
Semi-trucks and cars.
Right, semi-trucks. And especially now with the new designs for the semi-trucks, it's really to work on the vortices and the back. Is anybody a golf player? Kind of. No golf players?
No, not really.
Not really. Okay, that's fine. There's no hate. It's okay. If you don't like golf, it's okay. But it's a neat example, the golf ball. Okay, so the golf ball is also round. Now, if you get the ball to spin, the aerodynamics will make it to go a longer distance and even more precise. So even in baseball, the pitcher makes the ball spin. Okay, so when you look at the designs of the ball, soccer ball, baseball or softball, they have different grooves, different designs to get that aerodynamics, to get it to spin. So I'm just going to show you guys with the golf ball, because those dimples get it to spin, and the dimples, the size of the dimples and the place where you put sizes of those dimples will create less of the swirls and can lead to a longer flight distance or a longer travel time. So if you notice here, this is just a sketch. If you don't make it spin, it'll be here in A in the top left, which is what's happening with your ping pong ball. Now, if you get it to spin different ways, you'll have different eddies, and depending if you can use, again, that nature of it, then you can get it to go a longer distance. Now, any other examples? Let me go back to you guys.
Frisbee?
I'm sorry?
Frisbee?
A frisbee, yeah.
What about bird wings?
Mm-hmm, the bird wings, right? And they kind of flap, but you'll notice the curve. They're very light, right? If you think of the bones are very hollow, right? Yeah. Now it gets into helicopters too, if you think about it, because the helicopters have the airfoil shape, but they're using a lot of thrust or cutting through the air to create that lift, right? So it goes into things that the pilot can manage to try and go get lift, or that the driver and the team, really, with the engineer, with the chief engineer, can figure out, especially at each pit stop, how to get downforce so that the car has grip, more grip, so it can go faster. Now, we also talked about when you squeeze the fluid, right? And we were talking about how that's Venturi. I want to give you some examples about that. So we did the splitter, the effect of the splitter. So the Venturi effect is when you squeeze a fluid, it'll go faster. So one of the best examples is using the hose, right? If you have a hose like this, how do you get it to spray a longer distance? You put your thumb on it, right? So when you put your thumb, you're squeezing it, but you're also making it go fast, go around a curve. If you were to have an end, what is these called? The end on the sprayer. Inside the sprayer, you'll find something that looks like a ping pong ball. So you're squeezing and making it go around a curve. Mm-hmm. Now, even the Bunsen burners, perfume bottles, all these things use that. So they use that high and low pressure, because when you squeeze, you get faster moving fluid. to work in their advantage for their designs. Okay, so are there any questions, guys? So I want to bring up, I'm going to leave you guys, I know you're going to work, and I'll be at my desk. So if you do send me an email, you can, I'll respond. If you guys would like, we can kind of chat. There are other options where we can chat if you want. But I want you guys to think about, I like to call it parking lots, right? What are some vocabulary words that you've noticed? And through the badge, I kind of made you think already about some vocabulary words on the resources there, but also on the things that we've covered. Maybe some discussion topics. I know that I heard solar system for you guys, so I brought up some examples with solar system. So some neat discussion topics, if you would like some extensions or anything like that. And then, of course, it ties to your curriculum. So some ideas to think also is, what is the best concept that will fall into your classroom? How do you picture yourself doing these activities? And you can use the recording to kind of be proactive with that, or really force you to think how it would really go. And then we did incorporate roles and careers today, if you noticed. Would you feel that that is possible in your classroom?
Yes.
And then what types of roles did we not include that you would be able to include that maybe make more sense in the area, in your area? Okay. So are there any questions, guys? I want to make sure you guys are good.
I think so. I do have one question though, Marilé, just to make sure. When we do videos at the end of the day, how do we need to get this? Am I missing something? Obviously the badge thing that you guys have seen?
No.
Okay. So how where would you like for us to upload those? How would you like for us to communicate those to you?
The simplest suggestion that we had was just to upload it as a YouTube video and just send me the link to that video. So if you have a system that I can access with a link, that should be just fine.
Okay, that's okay. Awesome. We can do it that way.
Okay, so thank you so much, guys. It was awesome connecting with you. And please keep in touch. Use, when you go into the batch, just say, hey, I was there for the third part. But you can also use that point and say, hey, I've been noodling this idea. Can you give me more resources in this? Or can you give me maybe a little hint about this? Okay, so use the batch to connect with me. You also have my email, so don't be afraid to email to say, well, she's probably busy. No, because my job is to be here for you guys and to support you. Okay? Awesome. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you so much.
Have a good day.
You too. Bye.